Today's topic is something very dear to my heart and a topic that was covered or was done during my PhD back in 2017. So it's on lipid-based topical and transdermal drug delivery system. Okay. Right. As an introduction, I'm sure most of you all are aware that the topical drug delivery across the skin can offer many advantages. Right. So as you know, it can provide sustained drug release, lower fluctuations in plasma drug levels. It can help to circumvent trespass metabolism, improve patient compliances, and provide local specific in terms of dermal delivery system, and also a systemic effect by transdermal delivery system. Right. So, in spite of these advantages posed by the skin, the barrier function of the skin is definitely exerted by the horny layer of stratum corneum, which basically impairs the penetration and absorption of the drug. Right. So, just a brief overview. I'll just run through very quickly. So, the main barrier of the skin is located in the outermost layer, which is the stratum. Okay. And the stratum corneum consists of corneocytes, right? That's basically surrounded by lipid regions. As most of the drugs apply onto the skin, permeate along the lipid domain. The organization and composition of the lipid component is considered to be very important for the skin barrier function. Okay, so this layer generally consists of long chain ceramides, fatty acids, and the cholesterol. Okay, so the additional defensive features of the stratum corneum has a negative influence on the skin penetration. Right. So the defensive feature of the stratum corneum, for example, the low pH. Right. As you all might know, the skin is mildly acidic. The presence of enzymes on the skin, for example, the esterase enzyme that is located in the keratinocytes of the skin, they basically play an important role in the skin metabolism. And the transcutaneous concentration of concentration gradient, okay, based on its law. Okay? And also, the skin differs in terms of healthy skin and also a diseased skin, right? So a diseased skin is definitely more compared to a normal skin. Right. Then in terms of formulation, the factors that affect the skin absorption of topically applied agents are things like the size of the formulation, the shape, maybe the superficial charges, the lipophilicity, the kind of penetration enhancers used, the type of formulation definitely influences, and also the physical state of the stratum corneum, right? Right. But the exact mechanism by which vascular system is delivers the drug into the intact skin are not yet fully understood as of today, right? But they have been proposed a general mechanism reported in the past, right? So the four general mechanisms are things like the intact drug latent vesicle penetration into the different layers of the skin, lipid vesicles acting as penetration enhancers, right, via their skin lipid fluidizing property. Okay, this is something that we will be looking at coming forth in the presentation today, right? Other mechanisms such as direct carrier skin drug exchange by collision complex transfer between the drug integrated in the lipid by Lineker and as a face of the stratum corneum, and also the lipid classical mediated enhanced transdermal junction via the appendicular pathway. Okay, so be it the hair follicles or the sweat ducts. The other transepidermal pathway across the intestine, there are two micro pathways which are basically intercellular and transcellular as well. Okay, so like I mentioned, today's focus will be mainly on the lipid vesicles acting as penetration enhancers via the lipid fluidizing property, right? So, if you see, liposomes have been established for a very, very long time, all right? This conventional liposomes. They are basically nano-sized lipid vesicles. They offer potential value in topical drug delivery, right? So, they are formed usually by either one or multiple lipid milias that enclose a discrete interspace. And they offer many advantages as drug delivery techniques, okay? They are biodegradable, they are non-toxic, they are able to encapsulate both water-soluble and lipophilic substances, and they are similar to the epidermis with respect to their lipid composition, right? So basically enabling them to penetrate the epidermal barrier to a greater extent compared to other conventional lipids out in the market. So the majority of topically applied liposomes onto the skin, what happens is generally accumulated in the upper layers of the stratum corneum, okay? And it functions more of a reservoir, providing a more localized action. So it's going to remain on top of the skin predominantly, right? So in order to further enhance the skin permeation of the encapsulated molecules, alterations in the composition and structure of the conventional liposomes were made. Okay, so basically, studies have started designing the liposomes in different ways to generate new classes of lipid vesicles, okay, with flexible and ultra deformable forms. Right. So particularly, we have a few ones that are upcoming now, known as neosome, transposomes, and liposomes. So, neosomes are basically non-ionic surfactant vesicles, right? So, they are made up of single-chain surfactant molecules and thin combination with cholesterol, okay? These nanoparticles, generally, they resemble the same. They are very similar to liposomes. However, they are considered to be a bit more stable than liposomes, okay? So, they are thought to improve the horny layer properties by reducing both the transepidermal water loss and by increasing smoothness to the replenishment of lost skin lipid by fusion with the corticosite. The neosomes have the ability to modify the structure of the stratum corneum through their surfactant properties. Okay? So, in order to make the layers more loose and more permeable for the drug to penetrate. Okay? So, that's so bear in mind. The main thing about neosomes is they use non-ionic surfactant vesicles. Okay? And then you have another class called lithosomes. So, lithosomes are basically another novel kind of lipid carrier that has shown to enhance the skin delivery of encapsulated compounds. And they are mainly composed of phospholipids and a relatively high concentration of ethanol. Okay? So we are talking about concentration between 20 to 50% and water. Okay? So now you would think that, including ethanol would only cause destruction to the lipid vesicular structure. Right? However, studies have demonstrated that the high alcohol concentration basically allows the formation of soft, malleable, and highly fluid vesicles. Okay? So, ethanol is known for years to be a permeation enhancer, okay? And it's suggested to provide a synergistic mechanism with the vesicle and the skin lipids. So, inclusion of ethanol may provide the vesicle with a soft, flexible characteristics, which allow them to penetrate deeper into the layers of the skin. Okay? So, phospholipid vesicles containing ethanol may influence the bilayer structure of the stratum corneum and enhance the drug penetration. Right? And Next one is transposon. Okay, so this particular formulation is the type that we are interested in today. I'm going to talk more about it. Okay? So basically, they are novel type of lipid state vesicles that consist of phospholipid and an H activator. H activator is basically single chain surfactant, right? So I'll be going through this in the upcoming slides. Right. So so we know the existence of the lipid-based nano delivery, topical delivery systems, right? So how are they applied? Okay. So based on recent findings, it has been demonstrated that the conventional liposomes are considered to be little or no value as carriers for transdermal drug delivery. Okay? Because as I said previously, we realize that it just remains confined to the upper layer of the stratum corneum and are not able to penetrate into the granular layers of the epidermis, right? So conventional liposomes have shown to increase effectiveness for more of a local dermal drug delivery across skin in comparison to the free drug, right? For example, you have topical application of loperamide hydrochloride. They are basically encapsulated liposomal gel. Okay, so they resulted in potent and prolonged analgesic and anti-inflammatory action. Okay. Topical application of conventional liposome has also been used for healing properties. It should be noted here that the skin barrier properties are usually compromised with open wounds, which increases the penetration and absorption across the skin. Right? Besides that, liposomal formulations have been used, or rather lipid-based formulation system for topical delivery has been used to treat inflammatory skin conditions like atopic dermatitis, psoriasis, acne, and pathological conditions of peripheral tissues like inflammatory pain, melanoma, and as I said, leukemia. In terms of transdermal formulation, lipid-based delivery system has been used to deliver systemic agents for vaccinations, to deliver insulin for diabetes, and deliver estrogens for hormone receptor-based therapy. Right. So that's like the brief introduction on the current status of lipid-based delivery system for both topical and transdermal. Now, right. So moving on with this, I would like to share a recent work of mine on the development of a lipid formulation for a local transdermal therapy in the treatment of breast cancer. Okay, so the topic of my work is basically retinoid oils for local transdermal therapy of 4-hydroxy. Right, so just a brief introduction on breast cancer and the current statistics. All right, so WHO has reported breast cancer to be the second most commonly diagnosed cancer worldwide, with about 2.1 million cases and about 627,000 total deaths. In Malaysia, the current statistic is that breast cancer is the leading cancer among all the other cancers affecting the population. And in India, based on the statistics that I pulled out, breast cancer accounts for about 40% of all cancers in India. Right? And based on the 2018 report, about 162,000 new registered cases were reported, with about 87,000 reported deaths in India. So, like the worldwide as well, Malaysia and India is no different. Reported. Right. So now, just briefly looking at the pathophysiology of breast cancer or carcinoma, the breast cancer is basically a malignant tumor that has developed from cells in the breast. Right. So, like most cancers, breast cancer is caused by many factors, be the environment and the heritage. Right. Mutations environmentally linked to estrogen receptor. And hormone-sensitive breast cancer cells contain protein known as hormone receptors that become activated when hormones bind to them. So this causes a change in the expression of specific genes, leading to the stimulation of cell growth. Now, tumor cells that contain estrogen receptors, as you may know, are called estrogen receptor positive breast cancers. So, and almost 70% of the breast cancers reported are of estrogen receptors. Okay. There are, in terms of treatment, there are 6 different types of treatment available. However, this particular study will only be focusing on the hormonal therapy of breast cancer, right? All the available treatments are invasive and lead to many side effects, right? So besides the side effects, we're talking about social stress, psychological distress, and psychosocial support that basically affects the adjustment of breast cancer patients and influence their experience and adherence to the medical treatment. The cause of the disease. Cancer diagnosis and the treatment course can have an ongoing physical and psychological effects on the life and well-being of breast cancer patients, right? And more importantly, the cost of care is very, very high, okay? So it's also considered very substantial. As the projected incidence rate of breast cancer is likely to increase, you would find the associated cost to also rise. Okay, so that's why it brings me to the significance of this work. So there is the need for an alternative mode of treatment that will basically not only improve bioavailability or efficacy, that is also cost saving and enhances the quality of life of the patients. Okay. Right. So how does local transdermal therapy to the breast benefit? Okay, so how do we propose a hypothesize for it to work, right? So if you look at the embryological origin of the breast, it's basically as a skin appendage, okay, that has subcutaneous tissue, all right? And it has well-developed internal lymphatic circulation, okay? So we hypothesize that the fatty envelope of the breast may serve as the drug reservoir for a prolonged distribution to the breast, right? So aided by the intramammary lymphatic circulation, so that transdermally delivered drugs can disseminate through the breast, okay? As we can see from this diagram here on your right, studies have shown that the presence of thin capillaries in the epidermis and the dermis layers of the breast, as opposed to the skin from other region of the body, where the thin capillaries are found in the dermis and subcutaneous layer. Okay? Hence, this brings us to hypothesize that this local transdermal treatment could be a favor on our end. Okay? All right, so the twist in this particular work, another twist I would say, is the inclusion of ratite oil, okay? So if you see ratites, so basically they are flightless birds, like Australia, okay? Ratite oil have been used for centuries for topical relief, okay? And they have been used extensively in the cosmetic and pharmaceutical industry, okay? So if you see the properties of these oils, they are rich in polyunsaturated fatty acids. They have got presence of omega-3, 6, and 9. They have got essential fatty acids, vitamins, and amino acids, right? These ratite oils are known to have non-comedogenic properties. Okay? When I say non-comedogenic, I mean it doesn't block the pores of the skin, right? It's known to have moisturizing, penetrating, and therapeutic effects. And up to date, unfortunately, studies have only been done extensively on rhea and rhea. Okay? Very few studies have been done on ostrich or maybe even that. Studies have also shown that on emu oil, it projects anti-osteoclastic properties, anti-osteotropic properties, and anti-inflammatory properties. All right, now going back to the hormonal therapy of breast cancer, okay, the drug that is most widely used, all right, in breast cancer hormonal therapy, especially in the prevention and therapy of ductal carcinoma in situ, okay, is oral tamoxifen. Okay, now tamoxifen has been used for more than 30 years to treat hormone receptor positive breast cancer. Okay. It has the anti-estrogenic activity and competes with the estrogen receptor to basically inhibit cell growth. However, if you see based on studies, 5 years of systemic exposure of the tamoxifen gives benefits to the breast and the blood menopause. All right, so this includes side effects such as endometrial carcinoma and thromboembolic disorder. Okay. They are generally administered through the oral and also parenteral route. And based on the European Medicine Compendium, the current available oral formulation is tamoxifen film-coated tablets and also Soltamax, the oral solution. Okay, so, but if you see the chemistry part of tamoxifen, all right, tamoxifen is a prodrug, okay? It requires conversion by phase one drug metabolizing enzyme, cytochrome P450, to its metabolite, 4-hydroxytamoxifen and endoxifen. Okay. Now, this 4-hydroxytamoxifen and endoxifen have got better affinities for finding affinities for estrogen receptor, alpha and beta compared to the prodrug. Now, as you go the first part of my work, you will realize that I use more of tamoxifen and not for hydroxytamoxifen, only because the cost of the metabolite was very high in order for me to use it to optimize my formulation. Okay, so giving me a narrow window to ever develop the optimal formulation. Okay, so therefore, it's only feasible for me to use the product during the initial screen and basically use the metabolite once I have finalized the formulation and in the in vivo study, okay, which will be seen shortly. As of now, there have been a couple of clinical trials on tamoxifen metabolites as local transdermal therapy for breast cancer. Okay, so my work is not the first work. However, the clinical trials reported previously have used hydroethanolic gel-based formulation, right? So they've used 4-hydroxytamoxifen in a hydroethanolic gel. The problem with hydroethanolic gel is that it contains ethanol that are known to dehydrate the stratum corneum and increase the fluidity of the layers, subsequently enhancing the penetrating effect. Okay? So basically, I wanted to take a different approach, one that would not compromise the stratum corneum. Hence, the research significant would be to find an alternative drug delivery system that is safe and be able to deliver the drug directly to the site of the tumor while avoiding the first part's metabolism and consequently the side effects. Okay? Right, so coming back to the transposome that I mentioned a few slides before, now, transposomes are highly deformable lipid vesicles. Okay? They are able to penetrate the intact skin if applied non-occlusively. Right? They have been shown to have better membrane integrity compared to liposomes. And they are mainly composed of lipids and edge activators, which is often like a single chain surfactant. So we're talking about things like sodium folate, SPAN, TREM, right? The mechanism of penetration used by transposomes are through the intracellular or transcellular pathway using an osmotic gradient. Right? This particular feature is thought to enable transposomes to squeeze themselves through the intercellular regions of the stratum corneum, okay, under the influence of the transdermal pathway. Okay? They have been reported to penetrate the intact skin in vivo with an efficiency similar to subcutaneous administration. Okay? But the key thing here is, provided that the elastic vesicles are topically applied in non-occlusive condition. Non-occlusive means it shouldn't be covered on top of the skin. Right? So, just a brief explanation about the transdermal the hydration gradient. Okay? It's basically also known as the osmotic gradient. The gradient is created by the difference in total water content between the skin surface and the skin interior. Okay. Here, I would like to stress that the water concentration at the epidermal surface is about less than 15%. Okay. But as you go deeper into the skin, it reaches 5 folds, it increases 5 folds more compared to the surface value. We're talking about at the basal level skin layer, the water concentration is 5 folds more. So when the transposable formulation is placed on the surface of the skin, and are partly dehydrated by water evaporation loss, the lipid vesicle basically feel this gradient and try to escape the complete drying by moving along. So it's going to be moving towards the direction of water, right? So it's going to move along the gradient. And this can only be achieved if the vesicles are sufficiently deformable to pass through the narrow pores. Okay. I would like to also point out here that this system, again stressing, works only under non-occlusive conditions, as basically occlusion prevents the vesicle penetration into and through the intact skin, as if it deprives the vesicle from the main driving force. Okay. So basically, this is what happens, right? So the deformation leads to dehydration, and then rehydration leads to deformation of the formulation. The phospholipid hydrophilicity plays a part in which it tends to avoid any dry surrounding, okay, which causes the vesicles to resist the dehydration at the skin surface. Okay, and hence, for it to remain swollen, it has to follow the local transdermal gradient moving deeper into the skin structure. Okay? And the edge activator or the surfactant here plays a role in providing flexibility. Now, moving on, bringing all this together, we developed the formulation and we did physical chemical characterization, optimizing spectrum, right? So the transposons were prepared using a thin film hydration technique. And like I mentioned, it was formulated using the soy phosphatase choline, each activator, the ratite oil. So here we tried either with ostrich or oil. And using tamoxifen, and the final formulations for hydroxyfen. Okay. They were subjected in rotary evaporation for 40 degrees for an hour, and then reduction in size using an ultrasonic. Okay. And then the deposited film was hydrated with PBS. Rehydrated with PBS before reducing in size. And we use DCM as the solvent base for the formulation process. Okay, so for optimizing purposes, we tried 5 different ratios of SPC and and we use 3 different edge activators. Okay, so sodium folate, sodium taurocholate, and sodium deoxycholate. And we ensured the final lipid concentration to be 5%. And the final drug concentration to be about 0.1%. Right, so after developing the formulation, we screened all the formulation to find the most optimum formulation. So we performed the physical chemical characterization by studying drug entrapment efficiency, vesicle size analysis, transmission electron microscopy, residual solvent analysis, differential scanning colorimetry, and also physical. So, from the drug entrapment efficiency studies, overall, all the formulations, before that, I have to stress that the drug content was assayed using a validated reverse phase HPLC. Right? So, overall, all the formulation had more than 50% entrapment efficiency. With the highest drug entrapment efficiency observed in 85-15 ratios of SPC to DEA, in which sodium deoxycholate was the surfactant. All right. So the high entrapment efficiency here, like, overall could be because of the increased bilayer and the lipophilicity and reduced permeability of the bilayers. Okay, so basically leading to an effective intercollection of lipophilic drug within the hydrophobic core of the bilayer, okay, that causes enhanced drug entrapment efficiency. The preparation method could also have contributed to the increase in entrapment efficiency. Formation of a thin film with large surface area, basically, and enables complete hydration of vesicles. Okay? Right. And then we moved on to do particle size analysis. So all formulations showed vesicle size in the nano range. The smaller particle was preferred, of course, as it increases the surface area for the penetration. There was no significant difference observed among the vesicle size of the formable lipophilic in the presence of different ejecting agents. Okay? However, within each surfactant group, the difference in vesicle size between the formulation was significant. With increase in vesicle size in formulation with retide ores. So the moment you add retide ores, you notice the vesicle size were larger. Right, and in this case, based on the physical particle size analysis, we found that sodium taurocholate produced the smaller size vesicles for all the formulations. In terms of particle distribution, size distribution, the PDI values for all the formulations were below one, basically emphasizing that the vesicles were all dispersed. Right. We also did the morphology studies using transmission electron microscopy. And as you can see here, the surface morphology shows outline and core of the well-identified spherical vesicles. There was a well-defined unilamellar structure obtained for almost all the formulations, except for ostrich oil, the formulation with ostrich oil, it showed a more clumpy vesicle and basically caused reduced stability of the formulation. Okay? So as you can see here, the double layer here, the whole formulation was a bit more clumpy inside. In terms of differential scattering calorimetry, we did perform a peak transition for tamoxifen alone, which the chromatogram is not shown here. And then the DSC studies was done on all the different formulations as well. And the decrease in DM value basically indicates that the retinal orbits basically disturbs the packing characteristics and thus fluidizes the lipid bilayer, right? The presence of tamoxifen did not alter either the PM values or the enthalpy values, indicating the entrapment of the drug molecule in the hydrophilic form transporter. Okay? We also did residual solvent analysis to check if there was any DCM still present in the formulation. However, gas chromatography studies for that showed no presence of DCM. Finally, we did the physical stability studies. Okay, so the stability studies was done under two environments, under 24 degrees and refrigerated condition, room temperature and refrigerated condition. But however, we found that the refrigerated conditions were the best. Okay, and as you can see, visually when we inspected, there was a separation in the oil layer for both the retide oil formulations for 4 weeks onwards. However, the plain formulation without the retide oil didn't show any appreciable changes visually. Okay, and as you can see, over time, the vesicle size increased and the entrapment efficiency as well decreased. Right? So the best here would be still the formulation without the retide oils. So when we pulled together all our findings, we managed to conclude that sodium taurocholate was the best or the most suitable eject inhibitor compared to the other two, sodium cholate and deoxycholate, giving a good treatment efficiency between 65 to 90% and a good vesicle size as well. The developed transfer zone showed no residues of TCMs and was stable for up to 4 weeks in refrigerated conditions. Right, and we selected the three ratios for in vitro or sorry ex vivo. Right. So now that we managed to optimize the formulation that we wanted, we carried on to the ex vivo study. So we used biological skin. Okay, basically we used the skin from porcine here. We put it mounted it on transdiffusion cell, and we studied the permeation across that. We studied for a few characteristics, so cumulative amount permeated, the max flux, permeability coefficient, and also the enhancement ratio. Okay. So based on the cumulative amount permeated, we still find that the formulation without the ratite oils showed better penetration or higher penetration. However, the formulation with emu oil showed good release profile. Okay, almost very similar to the one without any ratite oil. Okay, so this could be justified by the presence of high oleic acid in emu oil. Okay. However, if you notice in ostrich oil, the formulation with ostrich oil, the last three lines here, had a poor release profile. All right. This could be because of the presence of oleic acid. All right. So basically, oleic acid, okay, why I say oleic acid is good is because it's the known permeation enhancer. The bent conformation is known intercalate between the liposomal bilayer, causing decreased phase transition temperature of the skin lipid and increase in their fluidity. Okay. However, contrary, high content of saturated fatty acid, which is the palmitic acid found in ostrich oil, are of linear shape. Okay. Hence, it has a reduced capability to disrupt the lipid packing of the stratum corneum. Okay. And it's difficult for it to intercalate with the lipid bilayers, resulting in a poor formation. Right, so based on the permeability parameters, amount of tamoxifen permeated at 10 hours was significantly increased compared to the control. Okay, so control was just plain tamoxifen. Transfer zone formulation in this study exhibited a marked increase in JNX in comparison to the control. Okay, so this can be explained through the mechanism in which the vesicle act as a penetration enhancer. The vesicle bilayers basically enter the stratum corneum and subsequently modify its intercellular lipids and consequently increase it. High affinity of phospholipids for biological membranes results in the mixing of the vesicle phospholipid bilayers with the intercellular lipid bilayers of the skin. Okay, so contributing to the permeability enhancement of the transfer zone. Okay, so from this study, we found out that 85-15 ratio of phosphatidylene choline and the age activator, which is sodium thiophenate, was selected to be the most suitable formulation composition, a higher permeation rate compared to other ratios. So like I said previously, from the optimized formulation, now we included 4-OHT instead of tamoxifen, we included 4-OHT. And we did a brief run through of the physical chemical characterization once again, more importantly, the entrapment efficiency and the vesicle size, and also the permeability characteristics studies as well, right? So you may ask, how can you just replace 4-OHT and tamoxifen? Okay, just like to you all to know that both of them are lipophilic drugs with log P values, with almost similar log P values. And being a lipophilic drug, the characteristic between the 4-OHT transfer zone formulation and tamoxifen transfer zone formulation did not differ significantly. Okay? And however, the increase in flux for all the formulation, 4-OHT formulation compared to the tamoxifen, if you see the flux, you will notice that increase compared to the tamoxifen formulation Right. This could be attributed to the presence of the extra hydroxyl group in for OHD compared to tamoxifen. Right. So the overall maximum drug release from DLT and DLT-EO, which is the formulation without EO oil and the one with EO oil, were found to be only about 7 to 8% of the initial amount. Okay, so not so much went in, but about 7 to 8% of the initial. Okay, so in summary, overall, the maximum drug release, like I said, was between 7 to 8%, and considering the use of biological membrane compared to the artificial oxygen, right? So this is basically the summary. So we moved on further from this work to remove ostrich oil from the and we focus more on using EO oil. Okay. This work has been published in Journal of Glycosome Research this year. Okay, so these are the two formulations that were used moving forward for the in vivo study. Okay. Right. Now, for the in vivo studies, okay, so we did two. Basically, the in vivo studies were broken down into two sections. So phase one was the toxicity studies, or I would say the skin irritancy study, and the phase two was to study the efficacy of the formulation. Okay. Now for the phase one, which is the skin irritancy study, the formulation, we did not try ostrich oil, yeah? So we just studied the EO oil and the empty transposons and the formulation. Right, so we assessed it based on the trace irritation score and took skin biopsies for all the treated individuals. Okay, and what we found is, so basically these were the mice shaved. There was no skin irritation potential in the formulations from the applications, so be it the formulations or even the pure oil in this case. Histopathological analysis on all the five groups, okay, normal epidermis with all intact layers of squamous epithelium and no evidence of any discontinuity, ulceration, or blistering. So, now, moving to the last link of the study, which is the phase two, the study of the efficacy of EMO oil-based transposon formulation. So what we did was we took six mice that were 6 weeks old, shaved, and we basically induced breast cancer in these mice. Right. So how we did that was based on an established method. Okay, where we used 10 to the power of 4 concentration of 41 tumor cells that were injected subcutaneously into the mammary gland on shaved mice, right? So post inoculation, the experiment was conducted for 40 days when tumor was palpable. So once it was palpable, we started to apply the topical formulation for 18 days on a 2 centimeter square surface area of the breast skin of shaved mice. And during the period of the experiment, volume of the tumor was measured daily, and on the last day the animals were humanely killed. Right, so before the mice were knocked out, the blood was withdrawn via cardiac puncture, and at autopsy various organs, specifically the lung, liver, brain and tumor, were harvested from this pathology study. So, like I said, the efficacy was studied on 3 levels. Okay? So, firstly, the tumor volume was studied. We quantified the amount of OHD and tamoxifen in the blood plasma. And also, we did the histopathological study, okay, of the formulations with and without the EMO oil. Firstly, in terms of tumor volume, okay, based on our finding, we found that the EMU oil, the pure EMU oil versus the untreated group, showed a marked difference in tumor size. Right? So as you can see, this is the untreated group and the EMU or at least the one in purple, there was a marked difference in the mice treated with UV1. Secondly, the four OHT transposome formulations, all right, so the one with and without the UV1 versus the untreated group were also very good in the sense that it showed a substantial decrease in tumor volume from day 40 towards the last 3 days you find in mice treated with them. Thirdly, however, there was no significant difference in tumor volume of the formulations versus the oral tamoxifen groups. Okay? And lastly, between the formulations, which is between the formulation with UV1 and without UV1, there was no significant. Okay? So the only conclusion that we can gather from this is that the transdermal application of the transposome formulations could reduce the tumor volume. Okay? However, they were comparable to the findings of the oral tamoxifen. Okay, they were good, but they were as equal as the oral tamoxifen. Alright, so next we did the efficacy studies using by measuring the plasma concentration of hydroxytamoxifen and tamoxifen. So plasma concentration of 4-OHT in mice fed with tamoxifen was found to be 2-fold higher than the one with tamoxifen. Okay. So this could be due to the way the tamoxifen was metabolized, causing accumulation of 4-OHT or lack of its equivalent. Okay? So that's why you can find increased amount of 4-OHT in the orally treated group. Secondly, the topical application of the transposome formulations, all right, produced a slight increase, okay, 0.03 and 0.01%. in accumulated 4-OHT in the plasma when administered via the formulation alone by itself or in the presence of UV1. Okay, but notice that the formulation alone without UV1 had a 3-fold increase in plasma of 4-OHT. Okay, so this only indicates that UV1 could inhibit the uptake of 4-OHT into the plasma. Okay. Now, these results were representative, if you remember, the ex vivo permeability studies on the bosanitin, where we reported reduced permeation of 4-OHT in the patients with UV1. Okay. However, despite the lower levels of 4-OHT, the formulations with UV1 showed a similar reduction in tubular volume as compared to the formulation without UV1. Okay. Although there is a reduced plasma 4-OHT, but in terms of tumor volume, they were comparable, right? So while 4-OHT topical formulation displayed lower amounts of 4-OHT in their plasma, their effects in reducing tumor size, like I said, was found to be comparable and similar to the orally treated administered tamoxifen. Now, the third part of the efficacy studies was the histopathology studies of the organs that they excised. The lung basically showed normal alveoli with mild scattered non-specific inflammatory cells, while the brain was normal. Okay, there was no evidence of tumor metastasis in both the lung and the brain of all the groups treated and the untreated observed. In terms of the liver, there were a few metastatic deposits that were scattered in pure UV oil or the 4-OHT transposome formulation versus the oral tamoxifen. Okay. Interestingly, the histopathology of the tumor of the formulations were treated with oral and the topical formulations, we noticed a higher degree of necrosis was observed in the tumor sections of animals that received topically administered 4-OHT. Okay? So this presence of large necrotic areas in the tumor sections of mice that were treated with the topical application of 4-OHT, the last one here, the E, might indicate that many tumor cells actually died, and there were lower number of cells that were able to metastasize. This could explain why there were very few scattered metastases in the liver earlier. Okay? This was in contrast to what was observed in tumor sections from the tamoxifen fed mice. Which is this figure B. Right? Well, the necrotic areas were smaller and a higher level of metastasis was observed. So, in overall, the summary is that the formulation had very good skin irritancy results, as in they were negative for both in oil and transversal formulations. The tumor size reduction in OHD transversal formulation with or without emu oil versus the one with orally administered tamoxifen was basically comparable. There were lower levels of OHD in the plasma of the topically treated animals, and there was a higher degree of necrosis in the tumor sections of animals treated. Okay. So our main conclusion was basically this is a first study to report lowered systemic circulation of OHD, the use of emu oil in local transdermal formulation for the treatment of breast cancer. Okay. So, however, the only small lacking part of this work is probably in the future, like the quantification of OHD and tamoxifen concentration in tumor tissues would provide a more information to this regard, to give us a better idea. But nevertheless, this work was considered to be of high regard, and it has been published recently as well in the Journal of Pharmaceutics this year. Okay. With this, I'd like to conclude my presentation. I would like to acknowledge my supervisors, seniors, Dr. Umar Talani Sani, Dr. Sadamanan Niyati, and Prof. Kamukuti Radhakrishnan, and Monash University of Asia for funding this project. So yeah, thank you for your attention. I think I can take questions. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Thank you for your